know, so how you have to think about it is be honest with yourself on those skill sets and really make sure that when you are trying to go after a particular position that you see posted, that you are really zoning in on the specific set of skill sets that you feel as though that position is really going to demand, and really kind of tailor your resume a little bit to that particular posting. Now, I kind of jumped a little forward on that, but the best thing that you can think of is when you're, think of your resume as an extension of yourself. You are in the creative, so you have to be very creative in the way that you organize your background, your skill sets. For you guys, either coming straight from school, not everyone has a professional history of places that they've worked. So what are going to be the things that maybe somebody, an employer, would tend to look at for somebody on an entry-level position or straight out of college? It's going to be your college education. Have you graduated? If so, the field in which you've graduated, and the specific set of software knowledge that you have. That in our industry, especially for graphic designers, web developers, for sure, you want to lay out very clearly how the different software knowledge that you've been exposed to, either on a college level or on a working environment, and then really itemize clean and consistently your experience as it relates to that particular role that that potential employer might be looking for. With a couple of things that we see on resumes, it's very hard to sell yourself on paper. It is a huge challenge. Some people are great at it. You'd be surprised, some of the best writers are miserable at writing a resume. The reason is, how can you really sell yourself on paper when you don't really know all of what it is that they're looking for? I would challenge you guys, and as an exercise, and maybe you can do this later on next week, but print a job description that you see that you like. Could be whatever, but something that you feel as though you'd like to ultimately go into, and then take a look at the different kinds of job descriptions and skill sets that they're looking for, and get an idea of, okay, this particular position is looking for somebody with 3 to 5 years of experience, and they're asking for this set of skill sets. Do I have this right now, or is this something that I'm going to have to build up to, so that you are constantly building your background and your resume to the point where you are that much more marketable to different kinds of clients? Now, is there any particular industry that you want to focus on when think about it this way, the creative group and Robert Half as a whole really gets to see firsthand how the trend goes up or down on employment. We're actually one of the first ones to see what's the latest as far as trends in our particular industry, who's hiring, who isn't. And one of the things that we discovered last year, our industry hit rock bottom in 2009. Everything after that point has been steadily increasing. In the fields of web development, graphic design, the more experience and exposure you have to not only limiting yourself to print, but certainly going on to web or multimedia is going to be a huge, huge asset, not only for what's on paper, but developing that in your portfolio. So things that you need to definitely think about on your resumes is going to be what your goals and objectives are. Then you can certainly highlight the software skills that you're knowledgeable in. And then if you have any sort of history with a particular employment opportunity, you definitely want to write it down and how you best contributed to that position. Any successes, any recognitions, any specific projects that you'd like to call on, keep in mind, there might be something in that resume that resonates to the potential employer that gives them an idea, I could certainly use this kind of talent or this kind of skill set. Keep it short, keep it brief, and keep it consistent and simple. Use one same tone of voice when you're writing. Make sure that if you're going to write in the past tense, meaning that you helped develop the intranet site for Kelsey Siebold Clinic. And then the next bullet point is you develop.
The transform selection, I can rotate this eye around. You know, even though it's not pixels, it's just a selection. So that's pretty good right there. The only trick is once you've done that, be careful double clicking because you know that could get you out of the selection too. All right, so there's an eye. I'm going to fill that with white, which in my case is the background. But I want that to be on its own layer for the moment, just to be safe. Create its own layer. To fill with background is Control Delete or Control Backspace. Now he does look like a Martian. He's just not cute enough. But you know what I can do? Oh, this is a good place to do that too. New with CS4. You can Control T, and since this is on its own layer, Control T, we're going to transform this, except that we're going to transform it using what's called warp. The warp transform is this button up here. See where I'm at? Looks like a radar screen. If I click on that, I'm now in warp transform mode. I can grab the little handles now and actually warp part of the pixels. And not the other part. So I can make this eye a little more cuter than what it now it becomes like manga kind of stuff. Anime. It's the anime Christmas. There we go.
Hey, don't knock it.
No, I'm not. That's probably not what I was intending, but okay. Now, once you get it the way you like it, you've got handles, you can keep moving things around. You can warp all kinds of things using the warp mode. It is not, you don't have a lot of control. I mean, you have some, you can do the edges, but you see, you're limited to this grid thing that you start with. So it's warping in according to this grid. Is everybody kind of following the warp thing? Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. So you're limited to those 9 spaces, if you will. All right?
Can you make it more?
Yes and no. We're going to. That's CS5. Okay, so we're going to take that. That's this little check mark up in the top. And if I can deselect. If I Control J, that duplicates that layer. So now I have 2 of those eyes. And then Control T, this is the same thing we were doing with the arm. So I'm just going to flip that eye on this side. I'm going to try to keep them cute instead of just scary. In fact, what I think he needs, I think he kind of needs a stroke around the eyes, which we can do. I will do that. All right, so everybody have 2 eyes? Flip it, one back. Now, when you do a stroke around a selection. It's going to use whatever you had for your brush chosen before. So we have to check and see what our brush is. Otherwise it may be like this. See, that's a gigantic brush. We don't want that. I need my brush to be a lot smaller. Something that will fit. It's going to be black and about that wide. Yeah. And you can have the hardness all the way over because it's still going to have the anti-alias stuff, so it won't be all that really hard. What you don't want is one of these star brushes to outline the eyes. That's not going to hurt.
How does that look?
Oh, hang on. We'll get there. All right, but I do need a selection, and it's easy because I just take the top eye. Now, this eye on the right is on its own layer. The eye on the left is on its own layer. I need both of them on one. So Control E will bring that down. So now both eyes are on one layer. You have to be on the one above. It just merges one step down. I do that a lot. Control B. You'll get to where you memorize like 10 different shortcuts, and that's the ones you use all the time. And all the rest of them, you just kind of, okay, but now I need a selection. And in Photoshop, you can make a selection again, using the control, if I put my cursor over the thumbnail for that layer, it changes to that little box that looks like a little marching ants. That means it'll make a selection based on the transparent pixels. So that's what I need. So I'll click on that thumbnail, and there's a selection that I didn't have to get. Pretty handy.
How do you do that?
I just hold down control, and I click here. And it only works if there's transparent pixels. If not, then you just selected a whole layer, which is control A. You don't really, you know. Is this making sense? Are we?
Yeah.
Okay. Kind of up to. Oh, that's cute. You guys make yours cuter than mine. You always do. You gonna follow us, or you gonna?
I was finishing a project.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Ethan knows a
lot. Oh, okay. Oh, I didn't realize. Oh, no, that's no problem at all. May want to look up every now and then, though, because kind of, I think it's interesting.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so now we're going to outline this. And that is under Edit. And here's the fill that we did with the content fill. Content water fill, you can get it through that, but I don't want to fill. What I want to do is stroke right below. I want to stroke it 1 pixel using on the center. Actually, probably bigger than 1 pixel. About 2 pixels. That'll work. And there's an outline for my eyes. And I can deselect. And I need to make some kind of a pupil, I'm thinking. I'm going to use the ellipse tool. And I'll probably do that on its own layer as well, so I can move them around afterward. Fill that with the foreground color, which is Alt backspace. The way I remember that is Alt is alphabetically ahead of Control. So Alt is for the foreground, Control is the background. To me, it makes sense.
So
can't find your own way.
Alt,
it alphabetically comes first.
Uh-huh.
So Alt is always the first one, the foreground color.
Uh-huh.
So Alt, Delete, or Alt backspace will fill with your foreground color, whatever that is. It's not necessarily black. I mean, it could be anything. I can also move this selection using any selection tool. Just click and drag, and drag it over here. Now they're both going to be the same size, which I think is kind of important. Otherwise, it looks a little inebriated. And again, all back to it. Mine's cross-eyed, and I think that's cute. I don't know. I'm going to zoom out a little bit and see what it looks like. Oh, boy. Okay. That looks like Coach Z, but okay. You need to know that. Let's not go too far. That's okay. You can go as far as you want to go. I might make a hat for him. That'd be kind of cool. That'll do for now. Okay, so I want to actually merge the eyes down to the body, because everything's the way up. For now, it's fine. So Control E. So that one comes down, and then that one comes down. And now I've only got 2 layers. One is the ornament, and one is the tree. Okay? Now here comes some CS5 things. I showed you already I reminded you of CS4 Transform Warp and the limitations. But because it's only 9 grids, and we were asked, like, how do we make it more grids? Well, we can make it quite a few more grids, Photoshop. But it's a different kind of warp. I'll try to show you what it's trying to do. This is new with CS5. So far we've got Content Aware Fill, new with CS5. This is new with CS5 as well. On the puppet layer, and I did say puppet, we're going to go to Edit, down to Puppet Warp. Okay? Click on Puppet Warp. Now we got a serious grid, and it's not even a grid. I mean, it's like all these different little spectrum things. Now, don't just grab something and start dragging, because it's not going to do what you think it'll do. First thing we need to do is start pinning it. It's called pinning. Pinning is a new thing. Control plus lets you zoom in if you need to.
Okay, how did you get there again?
Edit, Puppet Warp.
Puppet
Warp. CS5. The first thing you do when you're puppet warping is tell it what you don't want to warp. Okay, so you pin what you don't want to warp, all right? You have options in the pins, how deep you put the pin in. The reason is because it looks at it as if all these little pieces are layers. Okay, so if you put it in just a little bit, it'll move a little farther than if you really push it in there, it won't move at all. Okay, so that's the kind of control you can get with puppet warp.
It's a voodoo doll.
Sorry?
It's a voodoo doll.
Yeah.
It's like you put
your
pin
in a voodoo doll. I didn't think of that, but you're right. So, the first thing we need to do is pin the guy's head. So whoever this is going to really hurt. All right. Okay, so we're in puppet warp, and I'm going to click somewhere right in the middle of the head. And that first yellow circle, what it is a push pin, just like one of those. This is what we're doing. See, we're taking one of these things, just imagine they're yellow. We don't have a single, oh, here's one. Here it is. That's what that is, okay? It's how far in you push it. And then when you push it in, what it's saying is, that part's not gonna go anywhere, but I can take this part and move it right around. And so that's what we're looking at. Sure, I just walked clear off camera. Okay. All right. So I'm going to pin a few more things before I start warping. First, I'm going to pin his shoulders. There. And there. And I'm going to pin right about where his belly button is, too, because I don't want him to go too far that way. And I might pin right where his hips would be. Okay. And I'm not really worried about depth of them. Now, but here's how you would adjust the depth. This is farther down, this is farther up, and that's kind of when you really get going on this. Right now, I'm just going to take this arm, and I'm going to turn this arm, click and drag now, turn it down a little bit.
That's creepy.
This is awesome.
That is awesome.
And I can come down here to the leg, and I can move it out or in.
Oh, that's awesome.
That hurts. I'm going to go. And if I click in the neck somewhere, then I can grab this other one that already did it and move his head a little bit. Dragging back. Got kind of a curious look, huh?
Like, why are you doing Christmas in November?
That's probably the look. Okay, puppet warp. New and sad spot. Looks bizarre. Really looks bizarre. And it is something to really mess around with because what you can do is you can take things and stretch the outside of them without moving the middle. So you can get some really wild effects doing this.
This is kind of like the bone structure in Clash.
Yes, yes. I think awesome. That's where it came from. Yeah. That's what I'm thinking.
This is too cool. Tell me.
When you get it where you like it, then you do the check mark. And it takes it. And you notice it goes back to the first stage, and just for a second, has to redraw it. So he moves really fast there. But now he's been warped. Okay?
So once you apply it, can you go back and re-edit, or do you have to?
Once you've done it, no, it's not smart enough to remember.
Okay.
If you did it as a smart object, I've never tried that. Might be able to open up, I don't know, it wouldn't work a smart object, so that wouldn't work.
What is really a smart object?
What
does that mean, really?
A smart object, let's say you're pasting something into this that's actually a lot bigger than what you need, but you don't really want to get rid of those pixels, because you never know if you're going to make it bigger.
Director of photography now, so it was just kind of, he volunteered, and all I did was feed him a lot of good food and pizza, treat him to a beer or something at the end of the place, and he shot it all for me. So, yeah, it's a short. You had 2 days on a weekend. Okay, cool. Let's do it. I would suggest look for your strengths. Work in your strengths. And then if you're not sure what they are, try to experience a little bit of everything. You know, writing, shooting. Obviously, if you have a great joy in editing, be more power to you. You know, I edit on a necessity basis. You know, I took a lot of jobs as an editor. Don't get me wrong. But matter of fact, I can to teach editing really, really well, but my strengths are in camera, so I know that. But know where your strengths are. If you know your strengths are in editing, you have a good background in editing, or you know your strengths are in camera work, or you know your strengths are in the writing process, if you know your strengths are in the organizational side, yes, you can be my assistant director, okay? That way I don't have to make a phone call to make sure a location is locked or something like that.
Yeah. What kind of camera are you shooting with right now?
Right now, the rage right now, everyone is all talking about this, is using digital SLRs that shoot HD. Okay. Matter of fact, a friend of mine just bought a brand new one and I was playing with it today. I was like, oh, I gotta borrow this camera. But that's kind of the rage right now because, everything comes in as a file, so you don't have to worry about tapes and that sort of thing. Just make sure you have a good hard drive so you can back everything up. But yeah, that's what I shot this on. This one we shot on digital.
The Canon Z7? Or
something? Actually, we used one of the Rebels to shoot this.
The Rebels, that's what I was
I used just one of the Rebels. And it, the only thing about this particular brand, I think it was the T1 that you can buy, the T1i that you can buy at Best Buy, whatever. And you couldn't really control manually the aperture and the shutter. Of course, when we bought this one, they came out with the T2i, literally, a month before we started production. I was like, ugh! and that one now has the feature where you control all of that. So that you can get the depth of field and the shadowing without having to mess around with it.
How much
the
website?
The body alone can run you anywhere between $700 and $800. The lens, do you guys talk about lenses a lot in terms of your cameras? Okay. Outside of the camcorders, which is nothing wrong with camcorders, you guys. your lens is what give it that depth of feel and controlling your aperture and make sure that your whole background is blown out and gives it that, oh, look, it looks like it's on film. It's the lens. The lens gives you that, especially for stuff that's going straight to the internet or for a short film. For something bigger, obviously, you're going to want a video camera. Yeah, but the lenses, obviously, the 50mm lens will give you that, like you're looking at it, that same perspective. Anything longer than that, like 100mm and up, is a telephoto, it'll be a little wider. And then obviously a wide lens, 18mm, 15mm, stuff like that, will give you like this whole room, a wider shot. But yeah, all those, those digital SLRs come in very different sizes. You can get Nikon, you can get Canon. I'm not sure if Sony has a package or not, but I know the two main ones are Nikon and Canon for cameras and that sort of thing. Cool. Yeah, all right. Any other questions? Good. The goal for these series of shorts is just like any other, it's a business card. So I'm using it as a marketing tool to promote not only here in Texas, but also to promote East Coast and West Coast. The main goal, and for the hope for these short films, is that for each of them to at least get one, and I say one film festival screening on either coast. Okay? That means I have an opportunity to go and market that film at a film market. You have film markets in Toronto, you have them in Los Angeles, and you have them obviously at the Cannes Film Festival. Which would be really big if we got that. But that's the goal for these next 2 years, is so that it will be, screened. And obviously, I've kind of programmed it where you have four films coming out. So your chances now are quadrupled of getting screened. I've submitted it to, this one I've so far submitted to 23 film festivals. So it's up for consideration at 23 film festivals to be screened at. And out of those 23, their deadlines are not until January.
Okay.
So meaning they won't notify me until January. So.
Your old films, you put them on a YouTube channel or something?
Yeah. Once I went through distribution with them, it was funny. It's like I had two or three DVD people. who wanted to showcase it and that sort of thing. So, you know, I sent it to them, and they gave me like, I think it was $400 or $500 for each one, which paid for the whole cost of shooting the film. You know? Plus, I made a little money on the back end of it. And then after networking with a lot of my friends, it turns out an old family friend of a friend was working on a documentary. And that's how it turned into that huge, you know, account thing where it just, I was like, whoa, this is pretty intense. And, you know, I was able to hire a crew and kind of work as his, you know, assistant director to kind of pull everything together for him.
Do you shoot advertisements?
Do
you shoot ads?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I shot ads for a long time. I shot them for, there's a lot of money in advertising.
Well, who shoots the Academy ads now? What company?
What's his name? Lockie Bryant?
Oh,
I think he shoots them now. He's been in Houston for a long time as well. There are a lot of huge industry people who are here. Are you guys all familiar with them all? I mean, they're all in this production guide.
I've seen
this DVD. Okay, first off, as film people, you all should have a copy of this. This is the Houston production guide. Inside of it, let me just pass it around here.
Can you get it at Barnes & Noble or something?
This, you just go to the Houston Film Commission, and they have a website. Let's see if I can pull it up.
I have a copy. I'll put it in the open bag.
Yeah, just let them know you're a student, and I think it may be anywhere between $30 or something like that. It's not that expensive. I mean, you can buy a $24 book. But that one here has all the names of people producing in the city. And obviously, the bigger the ad, the more important they are. But I'm going to give you the names of the big ones. VT2, which has been around for a couple of years.
What's it called?
VT. V as in Victor. T as in, I forget his last name, Tom Baroli? It's in there. VT2. And they're located off of Kirby down there near the Reliant. There's also Locke Bryant. He's kind of a producer/director, but he shoots a lot of commercials here in town.
Yes, he does. So, well, I'm wondering, are for our students.
Yeah.
So apparently in Houston, our graduates focus on commercial,
mm-hmm.
They can also focus on short film.
Yes. They can also...
pretty equal. Which one would you suggest?
I would suggest working to get your ground level, like kind of like I started in advertising. It's always a good place to start. But keep in mind, know where your goal is. If you're wanting to go and begin to do the feature film aspect and become a director and that sort of thing, keep that on your back burner. I mean, make sure you keep your contacts going, you know? But I would definitely start in advertising. That's kind of what I did. I started shooting, you know, car dealerships, and you know, matter of fact, I had two or three friends of mine who I graduated college with, and they were starting up their own production companies, and I'd go and work with them as assistants, mm-hmm. You know, get paid for the day, and then help them shoot a car commercial, you know, or help them shoot a dentist, or not shoot a dentist, film a dentist.
That's what I said. I went to the Renaissance Festival to shoot fairings for my ethics project.
You're like, what? What did the fairies do to you? But yeah, I would say start in the advertising field. You know, if you're looking to, you know, make get some experience, plus make a little money on the side, mm-hmm. It's a good place to start. Dallas and Austin are options if those options are there for you. You know, definitely go up to Dallas. Go out to Austin. Dallas, obviously, because there's so many corporate headquarters there, they're always constantly shooting something. And obviously, a lot of the TV shows right now are being shot there. NBC's Chase. What other shows? There's like three shows that are being shot up there in Dallas right now. So, I mean, you guys have seen that Chase that's based here in Houston, but
yeah,
shot in Dallas.
There's another one, I think,
Lone
Star.
Yeah, Lone Star, I think. Yeah.
Did you participate in the South by Southwest?
Yes, South by Southwest. I actually submitted that to them. So, South by Southwest is good. Also, if you guys can go and check out your competition, meaning like people who are doing feature films locally, people who are shooting feature or shorts locally, See how they're doing. And in many cases, they won't become your competition anymore. They'll become people who want to work with you as well. And I find that to be the case many, many, many times. For example, it's like, I'll bring this and show you guys what I'm working with, you know, and then I'll say, hey, what are you working on? Hey, do you